This program was brought to you in part by the Edison Foundation, which works to encourage a greater understanding of the production, delivery, and use of electric power to foster economic progress, to ensure a safe and clean environment, and to improve the quality of life for all people. Additional funding provided by ITC Holdings Corporation. ITC is committed to advancing STEM education and nurturing tomorrow's power engineers who will develop the grid of the future.
I have four great-grandchildren, and you can't help but ask yourself, what kind of a world are they going to inherit?
America's energy future. There's a lot of questions.
But it's not going to happen overnight. How do you shorten that timeline, though?
Questions that demand answers.
It's a race to the best battery.
Our national security depends on it.
That, in military terms, is too high a cost.
Our way of life demands it.
This is what we're actually breathing.
Last time on Beyond the Light Switch, we traveled America looking at our energy options. This time around, we'll go on a journey to find our energy future.
Do you go to the gas station or do you plug it in?
I plug it in.
She's going to think electric cars are normal.
Join me, David Biello, as I look for signs of a newly electrified America.
How many times have you been pulled over in this thing?
Never.
In the next hour of Beyond the Light Switch.
Here we are in New York City, downtown. It's a hive of human activity and movement. Movement of people, movement of goods, movement of information. But what if all that movement were to stop? What would that mean for our economy, our national security? No goods getting to market, no people getting to work, no information to feed Wall Street. American life would grind to a halt. We cannot keep doing what we've been doing. Otherwise, we're putting the American way of life and American lives at risk.
Tell me what that was like, driving the fuel convoys.
It was very nerve-wracking.
Go, go! This is former Army Specialist Robin Eckstein. She knows a thing or two about American lives being at risk.
I remember the first time we drove through a marketplace. We were all on alert, you know, safety's off, and they're like, get ready, because they've hit us here before, and you know, we got through that initial push, and I threw up. I lost it. It was very unnerving.
In 2003, Robin was deployed to Iraq with the 123rd Main Support Battalion. Their number one mission, moving supplies, mainly diesel fuel, to their fellow soldiers.
Every time, you know, we rolled outside the gates of Baghdad International Airport, it was a roll of the dice what we were going to encounter that day. You know, was it going to be sniper fire, IEDs? Was anybody shot or killed? And it was extremely hard because we were slow-moving targets.
The convoy is by far the most dangerous job on the battlefield today.
Wow. Even more dangerous than being kind of the tip of the spear.
It is, because you're, in a sense, defenseless, because you're driving, you're moving from point A to point B. Your job is not to go out and kill the enemy. Your job is to move supplies.
This is Major Micah Rue. Major Rue led the 3rd Armored Cavalry Regiment through two tours in Iraq. Nearly 4,200 soldiers were placed under his command to guard the convoys.
So you were out on what I think was called Highway 1?
Yeah, so
Highway 1.
So Highway 1 is the main supply route for Iraq.
How many convoys are we talking about?
Probably a convoy every 30 minutes.
How often were there attacks?
Attacks were daily.
Typically, 3 out of 4 vehicles in the supply convoys were diesel fuel tankers, and it was Robin's job to ride along with them.
My job was to be there for the soldier to my left, the soldier to my right, and make sure that we all made it home safe. So that's what I did.
And get all that diesel out to those forward operating bases.
Yes, and get all of that fuel to these forward operating bases so that it can be wasted. One of my pet peeves was going out to some of these bases and, you know, have these horrible old army tents, and they hook these air conditioners up to it, and they're blasting, You know, they have to have fuel to run these air conditioners, the generators to run the air conditioners. And it's, you know, it's nothing staying in those tents. Also, I don't know if you, they use it to burn. So, you know, before they had porta potties and stuff, it was, there was a hole, you pour fuel over it, stir it, light it on fire.
They did the same thing in Vietnam, apparently.
Yeah. So apparently, you know, they hadn't figured out a different way to do it.
Beyond latrine duty, some of the diesel was used in conventional ways, gassing up vehicles like Humvees and Jeeps. But as Robin hints at, a lot of the diesel had another less conventional yet indispensable use for today's armed forces, to generate electricity. No diesel means no juice, which means no technology like laptops, night vision goggles, and GPS. And no technology means no 21st century American warfighter taking out the enemy.
Now, when you're trucking up fuel, that's essentially a bomb that driving.
It's very, very dangerous, and the results from those attacks are catastrophic.
So is that kind of the preferred target then?
Because it's the biggest bang for their buck.
Diesel to run vehicles, more diesel to make electricity. Now the convoys were bringing in diesel to power tanks, not to engage the enemy, but to protect the very convoys bringing in the diesel fuel. The military caught in a downward spiral of ever-increasing fossil fuel consumption.
I lost friends because I've seen people get injured when they didn't need to be.
Your friends were dying for fuel.
Exactly.
Forces that were in Iraq and Afghanistan were seeing that the amount of fuel we use and the way we're using fuel in combat was creating a problem, was a vulnerability. People were having to move too much fuel, having to protect too much fuel, having to clear the routes for too much fuel, and they were asking for a better way to do this.
Military operations over the years, you always have a logistical and supply problem to maintain your field. But recently, we've of course seen it vividly as we see supply trucks blown up as they're going into Afghanistan. And of course, that means, first of all, people losing their lives, and second of all, the net cost of the fuel by the time you get there is astronomical.
By 2008, the Pentagon finally had to act. The cost of oil had skyrocketed to $147 a barrel. Ever since, a cultural upheaval in how all branches of the military approach energy use has been underway.
It's what we would call, you know, a boots on the ground question. You want to make sure that your force is getting the job done, and if they're spending too much time protecting the movements of fuel, that in military terms is too high a cost.
Warfighter is not always thinking about energy savings technology on the battlefield. Man, I wish I had a generator that used less fuel. I wish I had a tent with a better liner.
You're worried about lives.
I'm worried about, exactly, my soldiers, my mission, and lives.
Major Rue's latest assignment sent him to Afghanistan. Not in a tank, but to survey how fuel is being used in a base much like this one. Major Rue then brings his experiences back here to Massachusetts at Fort Devens to collaborate with Army scientists on ways to save energy.
What are we looking at here?
So this is 660 kW tactical quiet generators with a microgrid.
And these are the quiet ones?
And these are the tactical quiet ones, yes.
Okay.
Since coordinating the generators into a mini or microgrid, Major Rue has seen a 30% reduction of diesel use.
Which means fewer trucks in and out.
That means fewer trucks on the road. That means fewer soldiers' lives in danger.
Much of what goes on at Fort Devens is figuring out how to adapt existing technology in new ways, like the microgrid, for instance. Or really high-tech things, like swapping out tent zippers for doors.
And that keeps the tent insulated, which means it stays cooler in a hot climate or warmer in,
exactly,
in a cold climate.
That makes it easier for the soldiers just to do it on their own. But imagine if I was wearing full body armor. I just came in from a multiple day mission.
You're hot, tired.
I'm hot, I'm tired. I don't care about closing this thing because I'm done. I'm gonna go rack out.
Much of the technology found at Fort Devens comes about an hour away from the town of Natick, Massachusetts, and the Natick Soldier Research Development and Engineering Center. Yes, the tent doors were developed here, but so is some real cutting-edge stuff, like space-age insulation that Natick scientists test in the Arctic chamber.
How cold does this place get?
We can get down to negative 50 degrees Fahrenheit in here. We look at all sorts of novel technologies, 3D cellular insulation, aerogel materials.
So you get an insulated tent, that means you're burning less fuel, that means less convoys, that means less people outside exposed to the elements or
precisely
enemy action.
Or flexible solar photovoltaics. They can be rolled up as shades or part of a tent.
So you spread that out on the hood of your Humvee, and you can both still power an item, and it's also charging the battery at the same time. The way they power these currently is they have to use fossil fuels generated by generators. When you're way out in the field, you don't even have that, so you carry batteries, you know.
You have to carry tons of these.
Tons of those batteries, wow. Exactly. Those and AA batteries. So,
man, this is not light.
It isn't.
But of all the impressive work we saw at Natick, the one thing that really stood out was a single strand of wire.
This actually has two thin metal wires inside of this.
Meet Barry DiCristofano, chemical engineer here at Natick.
Spirals around it to form the other electrode.
So this wire is a solar cell. Right. What good is a wire solar cell?
Well, the soldier wears clothing, he wears helmet covers, he wears backpacks, and they're all made of fibers woven together. So if we can weave this fiber into an existing item, we can provide power to the soldier where we're not providing it now.
The average Army soldier needs lots of electronic tools to do his or her job. This means the modern soldier needs batteries, lots of them, and the weight adds up fast. So what if our soldier can get by on just a few batteries instead that recharge by walking in the Afghani sun?
So this is the cloth, and we put this in the sun, mm-hmm. and it starts making electricity.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this is our little fake sun?
Yes, it's about as bright as 7/10 of the sun.
7/10?
7/10.
That's pretty good. Let's see if it works. Just like that. So the warfighter of the future is clothed in electricity. Do you feel like working on this stuff, you're saving lives?
Oh, absolutely. By saving energy, it's fewer convoys on the road. It's equaling, you know, fewer soldiers on the road, thus saving lives.
Does this make you an environmentalist?
I wouldn't say I'm an environmentalist, but I'm definitely more energy conscious now.
Did we have to learn that the hard way? I mean, a lot of people had to pay the ultimate price for us to learn that lesson.
I agree. I think we have had to learn a hard lesson, but at the same time, that helps have it sink in and the importance of it, you know, resonate more with people. So now it's, let's definitely not repeat this. Let's make sure that we get it right.
It's all about national security, how we use energy, the fact that all of our lives depend on electricity. Nobody understands that quite like Robin Eckstein, Micah Rue, and the Department of Defense. But how well do the rest of us understand this link between energy and lives, energy and dollars spent? Are the hard lessons learned in Iraq and Afghanistan sinking into our American way of life? I'm heading out across the country to find out. Another layover, and it's a rainy day in Georgia. I'm meeting with Joe Fuqua of Delta Airlines, who's showing me around parts of the terminal most of us don't get to see.
How many airplanes do you have in and out of here?
On a daily basis, we have about 1,000 flights a day in and out of Atlanta. That varies by season and time of year, but on average, that's a good number.
It's a lot of airplanes to move around a large airport.
Yes, it is.
They do say this is the world's busiest airport.
All these little vehicles zipping about, and all these jet engines running to keep an aircraft cool versus plugging in. That's a lot of pollution.
What can be done? Those little vehicles, the tugs, the luggage carriers. Here in Atlanta, a lot of them, they've gone electric, and I'm getting a closer look.
But all of this is electric equipment, ideal for this type of atmosphere because we're in a relatively enclosed environment. There's no emissions produced by this equipment. It's very clean, very efficient.
And it's easier to have a conversation down here near the tarmac. It's still pretty noisy, but the electric tugs, they're quiet.
On average, we're getting about 26 miles of runtime out of a single charge.
These vehicles run on good old-fashioned lead-acid batteries, the same batteries that help start your car. The batteries are good for 7 years before they need replacement.
With the use of electric equipment, we don't have any disposal of fluids. We don't have used engine oil. We don't have antifreeze that may leak out. We don't have to worry about any of that.
During those 7 years of battery life, a diesel-powered tug might burn 35,000 gallons of fuel. Battery power means major cost savings. Delta has been expanding their electric fleet, but the most recent recession slowed things down.
Do you expect this to spread to yet more?
I do. I expect it to spread to more airports and also throughout the system, because any carrier operating in an EPA non-attainment area is regulated to reduce emissions. So we see
that. Keep the smog down.
Keep the smog down. We're seeing that.
All it takes is a trip to the airport to see how movement, energy use, the economy, and the environment all link up. Now I'm heading to a place where if things stop moving, it could very well cripple the American economy, even if only temporarily. I'm on the move to our next destination, the port of Los Angeles. It's the biggest port in the U.S. On average, 22,000 containers move through the port of L.A. every day. Most of these containers carry goods from China, furniture, clothing, electronics, the lifeblood of our vast consumer economy. And when you combine the Port of Los Angeles with its conjoined neighbor, the Port of Long Beach, this complex becomes the ninth largest port in the world. It takes a lot of energy to keep this stuff moving, mainly diesel fuel and some nasty, sludgy stuff called bunker fuel that ships typically burn. And while most of the country may not readily think of LA as a maritime city, one thing it is famous for is smog.
I remember as a child waking up and breathing fresh air. I could smell the salt in the air. That's how clean and pristine it was as me as a child.
This is local environmentalist Jesse Marquez. Jesse grew up next to the port in neighboring Wilmington.
While now, there is no clean air. You can smell the diesel exhaust in the air 24/7, all day, all night. And it's been getting worse every year.
Since the 1990s, Jesse has witnessed the massive expansion of the port in order to keep pace with China's exports to the U.S. And this expansion has had an impact on the port's neighbors.
You have to realize Wilmington's only approximately 5 miles by 5 miles, yet the largest port is here. It's the largest container port, but it's also the number one largest air pollution source.
Many ports are isolated. The Port of Los Angeles is different. Here, densely populated towns like San Pedro, Wilmington, and Carson surround all this activity. Families and schools rubbing right up against a massive source of employment, and unfortunately, pollution.
When we think about air pollution, we just think of it in general. We see black smoke coming out of it. We see black soot collecting on our window sills and on our cars and on our white sheets, you know, on our beds and pillows.
Eventually, Jesse and his neighbors began to take notice of the effects of all this pollution, and the group Jesse heads up, the Coalition for a Safe Environment, was born.
Well, I have two children with asthma. And then someone else at the meeting says, well, I have my kids with asthma. Well, it turns out almost everybody in our committee had family members with asthma. Then someone says, well, my neighbor has bronchitis. Well, my neighbor has sinusitis.
There are a number of oil refineries that contribute to the pollution, but the amount of activity and traffic puts most of the responsibility on the ports.
What happened is that when we looked at the studies, 2 to 3 tons of air pollution comes out of every ship every day. And when you have 30, 40 ships at both ports here at the same time, that is immense.
Right. Okay. And that's the soot that's landing on your bedspreads and your window
Absolutely.
Sills.
Absolutely. So what we've actually been able to do now is capture some of that black soot and be able to show the public that this is what we're actually breathing.
Ships belch out a lot of pollution, but there's still only a fraction of the activity going on at the Port of Los Angeles. Once a diesel-powered tugboat assists in parking a ship, cranes running on diesel pull the container off and put them on diesel-burning yard tractors, which are offloaded by more diesel-powered cranes for temporary storage. But all that pales in comparison to the trucks. Heavy-duty tractor trailers running rampant through Wilmington, through San Pedro, coming from every direction. Lining up and idling for hours in order to get into the port to pick up a container and to move it to a big box store near you.
The results show that Wilmington, West Long Beach,
and San Pedro were at the highest risk of lung cancer due to diesel fuel emissions.
So that's the big problem, the diesel exhaust from the trucks.
Jesse took me through the neighborhoods of Wilmington. Modest and well-kept houses line the narrow residential two-lane streets, so close to the constant truck traffic.
Today, there are approximately 40,000 truck trips a day leaving the ports, which means they must pass through the Wilmington community.
And by the year 2025, it's increasing to 100,000 truck trips a day.
The trucks not only pass through these communities, often they must stop to pick up a chassis, which allows the truck to haul a container. Jesse took me to one storage lot where the residents live right across the street.
Right now, we're approximately 3 miles north of the Port of Los Angeles. We're not even on port property. So here you have an example where you can see the exhaust coming right out of the pipe of a truck right there.
Port of Los Angeles, because of its 47 square mile area and 16,000 trucks, it was very clear who's responsible for the pollution, who's causing the harm.
I'm talking to Balwinder Samra. Samra is a contractor here. He has a vested interest in the issues facing the port. I see
it.
It's
charging right now. It can no longer grow the port, even from a business standpoint. As I think it's been 5 years since they've grown a single square inch in that area.
Because there are too many trucks putting out too much pollution, lining up.
Too much pollution. And just from a business standpoint, they need to resolve this pollution problem so they can start expanding. Otherwise, they're losing business to Canada and Baja California and other Seattle ports. So there is an economic issue behind it also. Remember, this port was only constructed for 1.5 million containers. And today it's doing a combined Port of Long Beach and LA are doing 14 to 15 million.
Right. So each of those 15 million containers, there's a truck that has to be attached to that container.
Yeah.
So what is the solution? I mean, you've got thousands of diesel trucks, you've got hundreds of trains, you've got all these big ships coming in and out. How do you cut back on the air pollution, or how does the port cut back on air pollution?
We want the port terminal to be electrified. And the port naturally looks at this and says, well, it's never been done before. It says, well, that's going to be one of the conditions. You will electrify this port.
Electrification, switching any or all internal combustion engines burning bunker fuel or diesel to clean, efficient electricity.
Everybody said, you can't have standards. You're a port, you're not an air agency.
This is Geraldine Natz, a marine biologist by training and a longtime environmentalist. Geraldine was, until recently, the executive director of the Port of Los Angeles.
We have to spend $1 million a day in this physical plant, keeping it up, rebuilding stuff, repaving, deepening the wharves. Ships keep changing the size, the cranes have to get bigger. We constantly renew the infrastructure.
Clean air or jobs. One without the other does no one in Wilmington or San Pedro any good. So for the past 7 years, Geraldine and the Port of LA have walked a tightrope, going electric without driving away the port's customers.
That was one of the big fears. Were we going to lose business? Would it go to Seattle and Tacoma? And let me tell you, their ads came out, no clean truck fee, come up here, the no fee port. And we're like, oh, brother. So,
oh, those crazy Californians.
Yeah, right, exactly. That's, they like to talk about us. But, we have such a big market here. We took advantage of the fact we had leverage. We used our leverage for the first time. And it's really hard to do that in a customer service-oriented business, to use your leverage. But if we didn't do that, we were dead in the water.
The first obvious place to start electrifying was the various ships coming into port. The port made a place for these ships to plug in, allowing them to turn off their engines while at berth. Next, it started switching its cranes from diesel to electric. So far, 10 of their 90 rubber-tired gantry cranes have been swapped out, and the port has already seen costs drop from $30 an hour to $3. Even the tugboats guiding these massive vessels in and out of the docks are making the switch. Well, at least partially.
Some dolphins right here. This shows how clean the harbor is.
Yeah, wow. So do you have the best job in the harbor, if not the city?
Yes, I do.
So what's it like driving or captaining a
hybrid tugboat versus, you know, the conventional ones?
Well, it's a lot quieter, so we only have one engine going compared to other tugboats in the harbor of three.
Thanks to all these changes, the port has cut soot emissions by 75%. But if the port is to grow, it'll mean more trucks, more diesel burned, more soot, unless the trucks electrify too.
Which is forcing them to adopt new technologies or test new technologies.
And that new technology? Electric heavy-duty trucks. While electric vehicles aren't particularly new, scaling them up to tractor-trailer size is. So 7 years ago, Geraldine in the port called on Samra, looking for some serious horsepower, on-site and off. But while electrifying heavy-duty trucks seems obvious, there is a catch.
The truck has to pull a 40-foot-long container stuffed with VCRs and DVDs and toys and whatever.
Plastic tchotchkes.
Yeah, right, exactly. So it's heavy. And so that, you know, takes a lot of energy to move that. And then if you look out, you see the bridge there? So the truck's got to get up over those bridges and go down. Even today, you follow a truck over those bridges, you know, you're passing him because he's going too slow. So you've got to have an electric truck. It's got to have enough torque to be able to pull that fully loaded container.
I'm not sure how many VCRs are imported these days, but the containers at the Port of Los Angeles are big and getting bigger, heavy and getting heavier. A fully loaded container can weigh up to 30 tons.
So there's no problems kind of getting uphill or downhill or,
no,
or anything
electric,
like
electrics
that?
Electrics have always been more powerful than diesel because electric has the highest torque at zero RPMs. So power is not an issue.
Samra is right. Power is not the issue. However, the energy supplying the power is. Energy from a battery. Lots and lots of batteries. Batteries that eat up valuable cargo space. In this way, truckers are no different than any other American driver when it comes to electric vehicles. Their big concern is range anxiety. We're going to check out a neighborhood that seems immune to this fear to find out what will it take for electric vehicles to capture the American car market. From LA, we head out to the capital of the Lone Star State, Austin. Another sweltering day in Texas, the land of big energy, and boy, do they consume a lot of it. Austin is populated with people who have always seen themselves as pioneers. Part of this pioneering past is the moon towers. The city erected these early electric streetlights back in 1894. More than a century later, they've become so iconic to Austin, they were featured in the film Dazed and Confused.
Not to worry. There's a new fest in the making as we speak. It's out at the moon tower.
Some of these pioneers have moved out to the north end of Austin. Pioneers in a new kind of community, the Miller neighborhood.
It's the dangdest thing here. All the neighbors know each other. It was an intentional physical design of this neighborhood to facilitate neighbors getting to know each other.
This is Brewster McCracken. He runs a lab at the edge of Miller that tracks neighborhood energy use. Not long ago, this area was an abandoned airport, a vast blank canvas waiting for a new type of development.
The people who were in the first wave of homeowners in this neighborhood labeled themselves the pioneers. You know, and in a way that makes sense because airports are typically placed in an area where you're not going to have a whole lot of development around it. And so the people that first came here, they were living on a giant vacant lot.
This is a little denser. How do you feel about that?
I studied urban planning in school, and this was always the stuff you always read about, but you're never able to actually see. So, especially in Texas. Yeah, it's great. You can walk to the grocery store, walk to restaurants.
The real key to living in Austin is either you sit in traffic for a long time or you pay a fortune to live close. That's what it comes down to.
I think that's true in most cities, right?
Yeah,
I guess. That's the American model.
Miller is contorting that model in new ways. At least for Texas. Those drawn to Miller are looking for a new urban experience, one that places a premium on feet over engines, two wheels over four, pushing everyone closer together, including stores and services, to make getting around and getting together easier.
The model is you agree to give up part of your personal space in order to have this bigger community outdoor space. So We went from having a half acre yard with a creek in the back in South Austin to this little tiny 1/12 acre lot jammed in with a bunch of other lots. But I can walk to three different parks now.
It's a utopian ideal, populated with young, affluent, and well-educated families, tailor-made for Brewster's studies.
Knowing that a whole lot of people who had moved into an old airport site and named themselves pioneers, that was a good signal that that would be a place to reach out to test out the new ideas for a reinvented or changed energy system. And since everybody knew each other, if we could get five or six people to sign up, they would go tell their neighbors.
Our research was based on finding early adopters.
Mm-hmm.
And so we weren't looking for people that we were going to have to convince. We wanted to find people who wanted to be part of something new. And this is a perfect neighborhood for that.
That something new is Brewster's Lab, known around here as the Pecan Street Project. Participating homes are wired into Pecan Street as Miller families, like the Fishers, test new energy technologies.
Normally in a house you would have a main panel and a single meter, but we have a meter from the utility that captures our billing. Then we have a research meter from Pecan Street that sends data back to Pecan Street.
Grant and Ashley Fisher financed what amounts to the full Pecan Street package, including the family car.
What kind of car does Mommy have, do you know?
What kind of car does Mommy have?
Do you go to the gas station or do you plug it in?
I plug it in.
She's going to think electric cars are normal because you have one in the garage.
It's the only thing she knows, and so in the morning when we get up to go to school, you know, she knows that we go and unplug the car and hang it up, and I don't know that she even knows gas stations because we don't. I mean, I haven't filled up my car with gas for a year. So I have an electric car, but it has gas backup, but I don't really ever need to use it, and so that's all that she knows.
Anywhere else, the Fishers would be considered trendsetters. Here in Miller, they fit right in.
This neighborhood has what appears to be the nation's highest concentration of electric cars.
We have probably about 60 electric vehicles in about 1 square mile neighborhood.
And many of them live here, on the same street as Grant and Ashley. Need a cup of sugar, some milk, maybe an extension cord? Go right next door.
So what does your car run on, Zachary?
Well, it runs on battery power.
Is there something in the water that makes you all buy electric cars?
It's called incentives. And, I mean, we have a lot of people here that are really interested in technology, and they're interested in being on the forefront of it and helping to make it happen and be more of a trend.
Pioneers, the ones who bought without having seen anything. We were all, you know, we share that trait, being willing to, you know, put money down on an idea and hope it comes to fruition. And I think we were rewarded for that here.
Is the Miller neighborhood a glimpse of an electric car future? If not, then how do we explain so many plug-ins in one place? In the end, Austinites have not found a secret formula for making their electric cars go farther. Range anxiety certainly decreases when everything an American family needs is nearby: groceries, schools, work. But Miller does not represent the majority of America, an America that sprawled outward for the past 50 years, where patterns of movement have been literally cemented and paved into place.
Miller is a special place. It's not like this in many parts of the country. You don't necessarily have this kind of community of folks who are comfortable with new technology and are willing to work through glitches. I could totally live here, though.
All things being equal, electric cars in Austin go only so far here as anywhere else. But while the Miller neighbors may not worry about how far their EVs can go, the rest of us have to. This means what we need is a battery breakthrough. So we're back on the road again, leaving Austin's weirdness for Chicago's muscle. To ground zero of a new battery Manhattan project, so important to our energy and economic security that President Obama recently visited this new battery hub. We're headed to Argonne National Lab. The Manhattan Project reference is apt here. During World War II, Argonne got its start as part of the original Manhattan Project and built the first ever nuclear reactor underneath the bleachers at the University of Chicago football field back in 1942.
This equipment is very similar, and in some cases the same,
as the equipment that is used in industry. So it's a really good mimic.
Now they're being called on to invent a similar revolution for batteries. Jeff Chamberlain trained in chemistry and engineering. He's overseeing research on new battery technology.
Right now, roughly $14 billion worth of advanced batteries are made in Asia, manufactured in Asia. The market is large. Well over 90% of those batteries are made in Japan, Korea, and China. It would be nice in the next wave of battery manufacture if we had in the U.S. a big chunk of that supply chain, if we could get tens of billions of dollars of gross domestic product and the jobs associated with that.
Jeff's group makes batteries here. More importantly, they test batteries too, and the electric cars these batteries go into, searching for answers.
So this is our data acquisition system. I got plenty of signals and temperatures and other parameters of the car. But the biggest thing here is the electric, how much electricity is coming in, how much are we measuring. Right. But up here you see we got 346 volts. It's a high voltage battery. In order to get the capacity, the voltage is pretty high.
And how are the batteries holding up?
As you drive, I think the capacity always goes down.
What you mean is every time you recharge it, you get
a little bit less capacity. And it's a capacity fade. It's a phenomenon everyone's aware of. The question is, how fast is it angling down?
Yeah.
And if you if you're in hot temperatures, if you discharge it a lot like we do,
right.
I mean, maybe we're a little bit harsher because we're always discharging it to the end in our testing.
Right.
Whereas you might only drive 30, 40 miles a day. So.
Right.
In Chicago, we have one of these snowpocalypse days, maybe once a year, right? And your half-hour commute literally can turn into a four-hour drive. In those cases, guaranteed, you're not going to be able to get home unless you turn off your HVAC system. Because actually, electric cars do great in stop and go.
Right.
But now if it takes 4 hours, the heater's on the entire time. Now it's almost all the energy went to keep you warm rather than to get you to your destination.
Electric cars run on lithium-ion batteries, a bigger version of what you have in your laptop or smartphone. This begs a very basic yet profound question. Is lithium-ion enough? Of all the questions that argon is trying to answer, this seems like the big one.
Do we need something better to enable the electric car future?
So the answer is maybe. Some people will say yes and some people will say no.
Why is that?
We don't know the answer to that question right now. Theoretically, lithium-ion will not get us far enough to compete directly with internal combustion engine vehicles. In terms of the cost and overall efficiency of the battery systems, when you map it out in theory, lithium-ion won't get you there. So the reason I say maybe instead of no is that that's theory.
Start peeling the onion and more questions come up. Is the U.S. dumping millions into a played-out technology? Or will this 20-plus-year-old battery still have some new tricks? Elon Musk seems to think so, investing billions in a new gigafactory to churn out lithium-ion batteries with Panasonic for his Tesla electric cars. Meanwhile, the testing at Argonne continues.
The electric car part actually hasn't changed much in maybe 15 years.
Right.
Like it's actually an electric motor is smaller per kilowatt of power, but it's right here in the back. That's the battery. That's the part that's changing. In fact, even the chemistry and the recipe for each cell coming out every couple of years is a little bit different, a little bit better.
Right.
So hopefully that's going to keep vectoring to a point where we can have a lighter battery, 200 miles range, maybe 300.
Yeah.
And then there'd be much less barriers to entering the market for everyone to drive.
And we don't want that to happen somewhere else because then...
Yeah, very much so, yeah. It's a race for the best battery.
And whoever wins that race could cash in big. For nearly 20 years, we've watched the world slide into a new, totally rechargeable, battery-dominated reality. A battery world where the U.S. has fallen far behind Asia when lithium-ion batteries took off in the 1990s. Lithium ions were lighter and lasted longer. They changed cell phones from this to this. So naturally, they've been scaled up to go into cars, trucks, even dreamliners. But lithium ion batteries in their current form seem to be maxed out. Now the global race is on to come up with a new battery, one that's even lighter and more energy dense. From Argonne, we've headed to a convention hall just outside of Washington, D.C., in National Harbor, Maryland. What better place to find an alternative to lithium-ion batteries than at the Department of Energy's ARPA-E Innovation Summit? ARPA-E, the Advanced Research Projects Agency for Energy. It's up to them to slingshot America back out in front of the global battery race, an agency devoted to all types of energy technology, an R&D facilitator with a moonshot mentality, high risk, high reward type projects.
RPE does a lot of battery work, so in order to enable that electrification future, you gotta have a better battery. And a better battery means better science, better chemistry, better production, all the rest of it. That's where RPE can make a huge difference.
RPE is the urgency agency.
This is Dr. Cheryl Martin, RPE's former acting director.
People are focused on making it happen. They're focused on the conversations that are happening around us here at the summit, because the reality is knowledge and networks are how innovation happens. My invention today needs to be seen by somebody who pieces it together with their invention and it goes in a different direction. Or my failure of my first premise might be exactly what you need to move something else forward. Or some new learning that all of us thought was impossible becomes possible. And then the whole world opens up, because all of a sudden, all kinds of ideas we never would have thought of broaching as credible projects become something we can think about.
Each year at the RPE Innovation Summit, the titans of energy come out to see and be seen. That's the Secretary of Energy, Ernie Moniz, taking a tour. This is a fusion of academia, big business, inventors, and invention. If I'm going to find a battery breakthrough anywhere, this is a good place to start. This is Clark Gellings from EPRI, the Electric Power Research Institute. He didn't seem so convinced that a breakthrough was near.
And there's a lot of stuff, even out here on the exhibit floor, there's a lot of promising technology, but it's not going to happen overnight.
How do you shorten that timeline, though? So you're, you know, battery innovation seems to take like 10, 25 years. You need the batteries today to get, you know, the solutions that you want.
You're well familiar with that timeline. And you know that any substantial technology that has entered the electricity sector has taken 20 years to mature. It's true for wind turbines, true for nuclear power, it's true for most things that we see. And I think we are at the beginning of the 20-year curve for batteries.
Improvements in batteries do come in small steps. After all, most of our cars and Delta's trucks are still using batteries invented in the 19th century. Then there are the major breakthroughs RPE is trying to nurture. Steve Visco's company, PolyPlus, is working on a new battery chemistry he hopes will soon take its own place in battery history.
I mean, the beauty of energy technologies is that typically once they enter the marketplace, they tend to stay there for, you know, your grandkids will probably use the same batteries that you launch if you can do that.
Visco is exactly the type of innovator that RPE is betting millions of dollars on. A bet that his company, PolyPlus, will put the U.S. back on track in this big battery race. And he's not doing it with lithium ion.
When lithium ion came out in 91, and in very rapid succession, all the big Japanese battery companies followed suit, we figured that train's left the station. There's no way, you know, we're going to compete with in their chemistry with those companies, right? And as it turns out, 20 years later, that's pretty much proved to be the case. And so the way you compete then is you introduce, you know, the next version of that.
The next step.
Visco's been at this for a couple of decades, the length of time it's claimed we need for a battery breakthrough. So it's time to take a closer look. We're back on the road again, leaving the Beltway for the Bay Area. I'm headed to the west side of Berkeley. It's the industrial side of town, home to Visco's PolyPlus. Maybe he has some answers about the battery of the future. RPE has pumped millions into PolyPlus the past few years. And Visco's competition? Panasonic, Toyota, Samsung, to name a few. Multi-billion dollar corporations with even more backing from their governments. PolyPlus may be outgunned, but they're on to something. There's one battery I came to see. It runs on air. It's made right here in Visco's lab.
This is tied in, but this crazy looking thing over here, which is a bit of a Rube Goldberg, oddly enough, this is how we make our air electrode. Yeah. So what this thing does is kind of a fun
device. Lithium air means more power because it runs on, well, air. Oxygen, really. With PolyPlus's design, you can pack more lithium into a smaller space. This might be the kind of battery that could solve the range anxiety issue.
So I can tell you that we have tested the electrodes that come off of this line against Panasonic Air Electrodes, and we beat them 2-1.
There has been much speculation about lithium air technology over the past few decades. How much more powerful than what we've got now? Twice as much? Four times? If Visco is successful, the PolyPlus lithium air battery could potentially be as much as 100 times more energy dense than the batteries currently used in electric vehicles.
And this has been tested independently at 800 watt-hours per kilogram.
Wow.
So, but the magic has to do with having this structure, and this is what we invented. So PolyPlus is the sole kind of owner of this technology, and then this becomes the core for everything else we do. Now, if you combine this with, in a sense, air, you make a lithium air battery, that's the kind of holy grail of batteries. People have been talking about lithium oxygen, lithium air for, I don't know, probably 50 years.
The biggest challenge with lithium air Visco had to overcome is that air holds moisture, water. Mixing water and lithium, that's a volatile problem.
In high school chemistry,
you do
get together with your chemistry professor,
yep.
And he says, I dare you to put the lithium in the sink, and everybody puts on their safety goggles, you throw
right.
it in, and
you run.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, exactly. Yeah, no, so that's precisely the point. That's, in fact, why it's never been done before and would be, you know, on its face, you think it's crazy.
But it's not crazy if you can find a way to let the lithium out without letting the moisture get in.
What, this is just, okay, I'll prove it's tap water. Into that, I can immerse this device, and as soon as it hits the water, it's now powering that LED. Now, the thing is, that is a 2.9 volt LED, and 2.9 volts is beyond the breakdown potential of water, so no battery, no water-based battery can turn that light on, but there it is.
The protective ceramic cover perfected by PolyPlus for the lithium air battery has spun off yet another potential battery breakthrough. The lithium water battery.
We take these two membranes, we put lithium in the middle, a little bit like an ice cream sandwich. Then there are a couple of protective films that are on the inside plates. And then we just have to make an edge seal.
This is a pretty dense ceramic. If I didn't see it working in the water, I almost wouldn't believe that it worked.
20 years after Visco got started, neither the PolyPlus lithium air nor the lithium water battery are ready for market. A few hurdles right now, one being these batteries aren't rechargeable yet, so the race is still on.
If we're going to play in the electric car space and we're not going to get ourselves into a situation where we're as reliant on, you know, Asian batteries as we were on Middle Eastern oil, because that's really what we're talking about, you know. We're trading one foreign energy source addiction for another, unless we build our own kind of battery solution.
But maybe, just maybe, we're looking at this all wrong. More than once, we've heard that a battery breakthrough can take decades. But changing the battery chemistry is only one way to make for an electric car future. Maybe there's a more direct path to driving on electricity.
Trying to electrify the car that was invented in the 19th century. And that's, you know, still ultimately, you know, what we're driving in terms of its core capabilities and design is just not going to work. The 21st century car, we don't have it yet, but lots of people are working intensely on it.
Oliver Kuttner is a hard man to track down. He travels the globe plugging his version of the 21st century car. But we managed to catch up with him in Daytona at the International Speedway, where he and his Edison 2 team test run a gas-powered car that gets 100 miles per gallon.
What we're really trying to do is to make the car go as fast as possible with as little power as possible and have all the systems function. That's really what we're after. But we are functioning at a level where the numbers that we can generate, and we've already generated internally, are beyond the world land speed records. So we might as well set a world land speed record.
This is the Edison 2, the $5 million car. That's how much Oliver and his team were awarded when they won the Automotive X Prize. But as amazing as this car is, this is not what we came here for. What Oliver and his crew learned from Edison 2, they're putting into another newer model, an electric car, quite possibly the 21st century car in the making. And what better place to put the pedal to the metal than the Motor City, Detroit?
How many times have you been pulled over in this thing?
Never.
Never?
And this one, never. I'm looking forward to the first time.
Really? They're not like, what is that crazy car and is it street legal?
You would think, but no, nobody seems to care. So it's really interesting.
Oliver's pitching his potentially disruptive technology to the traditional car companies.
So tell me about your car.
Well, it's fundamentally a completely new architecture. Basically, by attacking the platform, we've taken complexity out and mass out like nobody else.
Oliver calls this his VLC, or very light car. It seats four, usually covered with a super aerodynamic skin. It can go 100 miles on a six-hour charge. Doing some math, this car gets the equivalent of more than 100 miles a gallon.
That's it for the battery right
there? That's the electric motor. There's a battery in here and under the seat and a little bit in the under the front seats.
Gotcha.
But it's, yeah, it's about 200 pounds worth. You can't do this with your rental car.
Wow. I feel like I should applaud.
This VLC weighs just 1,063 pounds.
If you take the mass out of the vehicle, and if you make the vehicle a lot more aerodynamic, it simply needs less power. If it needs less power, that means smaller batteries or less gasoline. So we're agnostic. We actually don't care. Charge time, battery cost, and range are all related to how much electricity do you actually consume. So if you get your consumption down, you can attack those things. And those are the Achilles heels of the electric car.
So what you're doing is making the car lighter so you don't need as big a battery pack.
Lighter, more aerodynamic, and there's virtually no friction in the way the suspension operates.
You know, it's pretty stable for a very light car.
Yes, on a very not so good road.
Yeah, exactly.
Kuttner is an automotive outsider from Lynchburg, Virginia. He says he was motivated to make this car simply to win the XPRIZE money. But America has a rich tradition of these types of innovators, and his electric car could change everything.
This can be really disruptive from a business model point of view, energy consumption, value to the consumer. It becomes a whole new segment, but it could be big.
Yeah. It's also an environmental improvement, right? Yeah. I mean, you're delivering on all fronts.
Even with the XPRIZE, though, there's still one big drawback to Oliver's electric car. Many Americans will not feel safe in a very light car surrounded by very heavy SUVs and tractor trailers. But radically rethinking the car seems to be happening more and more. There's Tesla and its Gigafactory. There's Google and its driverless car. There's even the kinds of micro-hybrids churned out by the traditional auto manufacturers.
When you're trying to put enough battery in to move, say, today's full-size cars, it's very difficult. But small, smart vehicles, you can get then the added efficiency benefit of electrification. Because as I said, electrification does make a car much more efficient. So now if you have a smart car that weighs less, is not overpowered, and electrified, we can be really looking at that order of magnitude, factor of 10, improvement in efficiency that translates to a very large reduction in emissions.
Reduced emissions is one benefit. Saving lives is another. Coming back full circle, the Department of Defense is now getting in on the smart vehicle revolution.
We need a lot of fuel for our vehicles. We need a lot of fuel for our aircraft. We need a lot of fuel for our ships. It's a great military strength this country has that we can go anywhere. But the question is, what's the opportunity cost?
Remember all that diesel fuel that the warfighter was using? Well, 21st century soldiers will still need some of it. But instead of sending folks like Robin and Major Rue to Highway 1, the Army is experimenting was shipping diesel fuel remotely.
And are you doing everything you can to minimize the risk to your forces and to give them the best military that they can have? So we've been looking at innovations that help take the risk out of that supply line and give our forces more capability in the field.
In the end, electrification means less oil burned, which could lead to cleaner cities and healthier lives. It could also mean more jobs, providing energy made right here at home, guaranteeing our national security by taking care of those three big concerns along the way: economic, energy, and environmental security. Which brings us back to Robin Eckstein, the former Army specialist who drove all those fuel convoys across Iraq.
We can't be wasting all this fuel and putting, you know, people in danger when there's better ways. Let's look at alternatives so that we don't have to be so reliant on an age-old fuel that's coming from countries that don't have our best interest in mind, when we could be doing something here, you know, clean, renewable energy here in the United States, shoring up our economy, creating jobs here, you know, making us more energy independent.
Everything is changing. Global competition is seen to that. So America needs to get back to what America does best, innovation. We have the opportunity to reinvent the American way of life, to create the future we want to see. Until next time, thanks for watching.
This program was brought to you in part by the Edison Foundation, which works to encourage a greater understanding of the production, delivery, and use of electric power to foster economic progress, to ensure a safe and clean environment, and to improve the quality of life for all people. Additional funding provided by ITC Holdings Corporation. ITC is committed to advancing STEM education and nurturing tomorrow's power engineers who will develop the grid of the future.